the most scrutinized, the most studied, the most sold book in the world. There's something about the Bible that's mysterious, it holds authority, and it commands respect. Even secular non-believing scholars have given their life to studying the New Testament, the Old Testament, and the contents of the Bible, which we Christians call the Word of God. Because I believe that even though they say they don't believe in God, in the heart of hearts, the non-believer knows that they need the Bible. They need to know the truth in the Bible. Deep inside in their hearts, they know they need God's Word. Because we're all just creations. We're all just creatures created by a wonderful designer. We need His Word. So they study the Bible, they scrutinize it, they study it. Because deep down inside, they know that this book, holds the secrets to human life, which they don't have yet. And my question to you is, what about you? What do you believe about the Bible? And what it says? What do you believe? And many people are cynical toward the Bible, toward God, toward Christianity, especially in college and university. A lot of Christians, they, you know, graduate from high school, they've been attending church, you know, all their life, and they go to the university, they take a philosophical class, and boom, they're not Christians anymore. I can't believe in the Bible. I can't believe in Jesus. Because the secular environment, the totality of it is cynical toward spiritual things, for transcendent things, for grand things. They just want to remain on earth. They just want to remain down to earth. They're cynical toward the Bible. And even when I was in college, I would be asked many different questions about God, about Jesus, as I was sharing the faith. And the questions that keep coming up, or the totality of the questions, was, how can I trust the Bible is true? Was the question. And I faced that. And that's why I went to seminary, actually. Because I wanted to find an answer for their questions. In my faith, in my heart, I knew the Bible was true. But what can I say to them to convince them? And I'm not here to present evidence for the reliability of the Bible, okay? I'm here to try to convince you and to inspire you to the greatness of God's Word and how we need that in our life to glorify God. And why we should be living according to the Word of God. And how the Word of God should be a big part of our life. More than other things in our life. To make our life count. To make our lives different. To make our lives meaningful. And why the Word of God must be central in the life of a person who wants to glorify God. Okay, that's what I'm trying to do. But I'm just going to share an episode that happened on a college campus to kind of encourage us, to kind of give us hope that the Bible is reliable and there's evidence for it. Okay? Let me just start with that. So it was in a college campus in Colorado, and this same question was asked in a meeting. And, you know, the question was, how do we know the Bible is true? And the answer was given by Ravi Zacharias and his colleague. And Ravi Zacharias is an apologist. An apologist is someone who defends the Christian faith. That's his job. He goes around the world internationally giving answers to the tough questions about Christianity, defending the faith of Christianity, that there is evidence for Christ, there is evidence for the reliability of the Bible. So they had this campus meeting, and the question was asked, how do I know the Bible is true? And the answer that was given was not evidence for the reliability of the Bible. It just pointed to the fact that it can be shown academically and with evidence that the reliability of the reliability of the Bible. Historically, archaeologically. And the person that answered the question pointed to a lady by the name of Amy Orr Ewing. Okay? She was a student at Oxford, and she studied theology. The last year in her undergraduate studies, she got a perfect paper in her Greek and perfect papers in other two exams, but she almost failed the last exam because the last paper she wrote was on the historical reliability of the Bible, or more specifically, the historical reliability of the gospel accounts. And the marking professor failed her, F. But the whole faculty decided to call her into an inquisition, into an examination of what she wrote, because her tutor said she got a perfect mark in her Greek, she got a perfect mark in other two papers, how can she fail this last paper? Does it make sense? So the 13 of the most prestigious professors were called into this meeting to examine orally what she wrote about the historical reliability of the Bible. At the end of the examination, they gave her the highest mark that she could receive. And the director of the department came to her. Do you know why you almost failed this paper? Because in your paper, you are destroying the life work of your marking professor. But you proved it. Historically, academically, archaeologically, you have shown that the Bible can be reliable, and it is reliable. So, good job. Gave her the highest mark. Go continue to do research and continue to, you know, write what you're writing about. What I'm saying to you is, it can be shown academically, but do I have to do that? Why do I have to show and prove that the Bible is true? And how we need it in our life? Why do I have to do that? Because there's a presupposition. Those who are cynical about the Bible, they have never read it from cover to cover. I'm pretty sure. They have never studied it. I'm pretty sure. They probably never even have touched the Bible, and yet they're cynical about the Bible, and they have a presupposition about the Bible that it cannot be true. There can be no miracles. There can be no parting of the Red Sea. There can be no such thing as God. Without even looking at the Bible, in ignorance, they will say, that's not true. How can that be true? You see? Do we have to follow that presupposition, their own presumptions about the Bible, without evidence, in ignorance? Don't be ashamed to defend the Bible and say, I believe the Bible is true. Okay? Case for Christ. Is case in point? Case for Christ by Lee Strobel. I told you guys about him, right? Yeah, he was a journalist, a professional journalist who began to investigate the reliability, the historicalness, is that a word? Historicalness of the Christian faith, because his wife came home one day and she was just changed woman. You know, I don't know what she did. I don't know if she, But, and because of the change he saw in his wife's life, he said, can Christianity be true? He began to investigate it as a journalist would, and he became a Christian in the end. He said, you know what? The only conclusion that I can make is that Christianity is true. Jesus Christ died for our sins. He rose from the dead. Is historically, all the evidence points toward the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. And he said he is who he said he was. He's the Son of God who came to save us from our sins. He's the Son of God who came to save us from our sins. We cannot ignore the Bible. We can't ignore it. And you cannot ignore the consequences that follow as a result of ignoring the Bible. Whether you know the message in the Bible or not, it affects you. It affects everybody in the world. Because they're words from God. words from the creator of the universe. It's universal. No ignorance and no pride of man will exempt that person from the truth of the Bible. No one is exempt. What it says in the Bible is going to affect every single person. A cynic, a skeptic, even a believer. And Apostle Paul said, you know, no man is my judge. My judge is the Lord. And so I fear. I serve God in fear. I don't care what people say. Because when all things have been said and done, the real judge is the Lord. And I serve him. Everything I do it for him. That's what Apostle Paul said. The word of God, it's pervasive and it affects all people. It doesn't matter if you ignore it. It doesn't matter what you think of it. It's going to affect your life. Whether you live by it or not, it's going to affect you. For good or for worse. So what matters is that since we all fall under the word of God, what matters is how will we respond to his word that's given. How will we respond to it? How will we respond to his word? The message of the gospel is universal. It's necessary for life, and it leads to reward. Okay? The message of the Bible, the gospel, it's universal. It's necessary for life, for your life, and it leads to reward. Okay? That's what I'm going to talk about. The universality, the necessity, and the reward of submitting to God's word. What it says in here. I'm not going to try to prove it. Okay? You can do that on your own. You could go on Google. If you really wanted to, you'll see how reliable the Bible is. But let me talk about the universality of God's word. Okay? Now, in the passage today that we read, there's no the word Bible. You will not find that, of course, because the Bible is a modern term, which means books. Bible is a compilation of books, 66 books in all. Okay? 66 books. All written in different time periods, pointing to one person. Okay? To God and his son, Jesus Christ. All pointing to the same person, which in itself is remarkable, right? So the Bible, you will not find that in the passage today. In the passage today, the psalmist, the person who writes Psalm 19, refers to the word of God as the law of God. The law of the Lord. And he begins by saying that the heavens proclaim the glory of God. The heavens and the heavens declare the work of his hands. And heaven, you know, represents the most majestic and the grandest of all creation. I remember coming to here in Calgary, and our house is situated so that it faces the Rockies. And there was this wonderful sunset one night. There were clouds, you know, and so as the sun was setting, the clouds turned pinkish and then purplish, right? Pinkish and purplish, and it was just so awesome, so majestic. And, you know, you could see the Rockies, and you guys, some of you guys, you're like, man, where do you live? I live in a two-bedroom condo. It's very small, but we have a good view, okay? So, yeah. But the sky, you know, and the sky was so beautiful, right? And that's what the psalmist here is referring to. I mean, look at the sky. Look at the heaven. You know, the heavens, it declared the glory of God, the majesty of God. Okay? That it's the power of his hands, it communicates. That's what he's saying. Okay? Day to day, night to night, it communicates. communicates knowledge. It communicates that there is an intelligent designer, that there is God, right? And so he starts with, the psalmist starts with the heavens. Why? Heavens do not speak, and yet they communicate the glory of God. God's creation, they have no words, and yet they tell of God's glory and his existence and his beauty. And there's nobody who would argue otherwise. Maybe now, these days, you know, in the modern world, but there's nobody who does not live under the heaven that God has created, in terms of the sky. Of course, we know now that it extends to different universes and whatnot. But everybody lives under it, under God's creation. If we believe that God created the universe and the heavens, there's nobody exempt. And this heaven, without words, communicates the glory of God. Day to day, night to night, from one end of the earth to the other. And he gets a little bit more specific, and he brings the sun into his presentation. He says, the sun comes up from one end, goes down to the other, and he describes the sun as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber. And the reason why he does that is because he wants us to know that under God's creation, right, everybody sees it. Everybody sees the sun. Everybody is living under the sun, under the heaven that God has created. And they feel they see the light, and they feel the warmth of the sun, and nobody is hidden. Nobody is hidden from the heat of the sun. His point is everybody is affected. Everybody lives under heaven, and they see the glory of God. All this is communicated without words, he's saying. And now he's going to begin to describe the law of God. After he finishes the passage in verse 6, he says, it rises at one end of the heavens, he's talking about the sun, makes a circuit to the other. Nothing is hidden from its heat. And then he goes right into the law of the Lord is perfect. What is the connection between the sun and the law of the Lord being perfect? Just as the sun shines its ray and affects all people, no one's hidden, he's saying the law of the Lord affects everybody else. The word of God, everybody is under the word of God. Just as God created the physical laws that govern the universe, right? And the physical planetary bodies must obey the circuit that God has created, the path. There's also a spiritual law by which all human beings must live by and are under. And so he's saying that the law of God, it applies to us all. It applies to everybody. So the universality of God's word is likened to heaven. Okay? And although the heavens do not speak, and they still tell of God's glory, how much more then should the written word of God, with words and with a message, glorify God and give us life and lead us to know the glory of God? And the psalmist, then he describes the necessity of the word of God. The necessity of the word of God. And he describes the word of God as being perfect and the benefits that the word of God gives to us. And there are six ways that he describes the word of God, and six ways the word benefits us. First, verse 7, he says, the law of the Lord is perfect. It revives the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. It's talking about understanding, you know, giving insight. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinance of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. And then he says, they are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb. Again, they are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb. In other words, he's saying that the word of God, the law of God for your life will give you more than any material thing, than gold, than money, wealth. God's word is going to give you much more. It's better than honey. It's sweeter than honey. Okay? Sweeter than honey. It will give you more satisfaction than any other thing in this world. And the reason is, verse 11, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. By them is your servant warned. In keeping them is great reward. None of us are perfect. No. Sometimes we don't know the error in which we may be living, and some of the mistakes that we make. None of us are perfect. Here he says, the word of God will correct that. The word of God will show us the areas in which we fall short. You know? Who can discern his errors? Verse 12, forgive my hidden faults. Right? Who can discern his own errors, right? And there are some even sins that we don't even know about. And the word of God will show us. And here the psalmist says, forgive my hidden faults. And keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then will I be blameless, innocent of great transgression. So the word of God is necessary for our life to give us life, you know, the wisdom, the joy, stability, and also to correct us from sin and errors that we have, that we make as we live. The reward. So the universality, the necessity, and the reward of knowing God's word and living by God's word and having God's word in our life. What is it? Is it a better life? Is it the reward for David, who's writing this psalm? Is that he will live a life that will be glorifying to God. That's the reward. The reward for living according to God's word is that his life will be pleasing to God, his Savior. That's the reward. In verse 14, he says, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. And so, we want to live to glorify God. We want our words to be pleasing to God. We want the meditation of our hearts, what we're thinking, to be acceptable to God. We want to please God. Why? Only if He is your Savior. If God is your rock and if God is your Redeemer, you will want to please Him with your life. The reward for living according to God's Word is that we can give back and love God. Give back to God for what He has given us. Is God, the word rock refers to God being strong and protective. Okay? It refers to God being our refuge. And the word redeemer, a redeemer is somebody who buys back what belongs to him. Somebody who buys back what belongs to his own. And so here in the psalm it says that God, He's my rock, He's my refuge, and He's my redeemer. And because God is my rock, because God is my redeemer, because God has saved me, because God has protected me, because God has led me thus far, because God, He's my God, I want to please Him. That is the reward for living according to His word. So, the universality, the necessity, and the reward of knowing the living God, God's word. God, thank you for your word, which reminds us how